paragraph 79. The interior of the raider vessel is unlike any spacecraft you have ever seen. The bridge consists of a single couch shaped to fit an inhuman form. There are miles of cables and wires coming out from the couch, all leading into a box about the size of a small footlocker. Lying in the middle of the couch, seemingly unconscious, is the strangest being you have ever seen. Its body is absolutely transparent, while its internal organs are a deep shade of purple. The raider gestures toward the reclining form and says, "Meet my co-pilot. It's a Varashki from the Ringlet Nebula. It navigates better than any shipboard computer I've ever seen, and it has the ability to blink the ship in and out of normal space. With it at the controls, we can come and go as we please, because we're always here, just not in the same dimension as you feds. Gregor found out about them when he did some trading in that system. He brought a few back and has been having us fly the raid so that he can raise the price of the stuff he exports to Rowan. I don't mind doing it because the pay is more for a single raid than I used to earn on half a dozen cargo runs. Besides," the raider says with a laugh, "it's a hell of a lot safer than flying a cargo liner these days." Paragraph 80. As you begin to slip into unconsciousness, the last thing you remember is Kedro, teeth gleaming, motioning to the others and saying, "Come, children, it's been so long since we've had a good meal." Paragraph 81. The blue light of the terminal casts a dim glow in the darkened chamber. "Accessing" appears in the center of the screen. After what seems an eternity but is in reality a few seconds, the screen clears and the following message appears: "Security violation. Access denied. Erasing databanks." The captured raider breaks out into maniacal laughter, then chokes it back as a look of terror crosses his features. "But Master," he babbles, "I did as you told me. They have destroyed the records. All is..." He clutches at his face and then screams a short, terrifying scream before he drops to the floor, dead. Paragraph 82. The Oaxaca lie, the reptilian, Kushal leader hisses. "We have lived here many, many generations. The Pale Ones arrived 2 generations ago and seek to destroy the people by hunting and smashing our eggs. Kushal no leave land of hatching. Oaxaca must die. If Oaxaca leave, Kushal pursue. Egg smasher always return. Must exterminate. Oaxaca flying machine no save egg smasher. We go to flying machine home and smash them. Machine home not far. Follow setting sun 4-day journey." Paragraph 83. "You have destroyed the Master," the key exclaims. "Why, you must be the new Sentinels. At last, your coming has been foretold, you know. That's wonderful. I never much cared for the old Sentinels. They had nasty habits, what with those hideous teeth and their thirst for warm blood. They could be quite revolting at times, you know. This could be the beginning of a new age. Let's go back to Earth. We can take over the Federation. I know how to get there from the Gates of Truth. The Gates let one travel anywhere if you know the secret. All you really need to know is the next 83 is 12. Paragraph 84. The Kaldorian looks around the room nervously and then motions you and your crew to a table in a dimly lit corner. "It just won't do to be seen fraternizing with the Federation Marines," he says quietly. "If my co-workers saw me doing this, I'd be cited for off-worlder contract and I might lose my job at the plastic surgeons. However, I've lost 2 close friends in these raids and I'd like to see the end to them. The raiders are warping in from the Rowan system. Their ships are of Malardic construction and use a special hyperdrive engine that allows them to travel great distances with very little fuel expenditure. You should go see Flock at the changing station of the dry dock area for more information. He has spent time in Rowan and has seen what the Malardic craft can do firsthand. Tell him Kronos sent you." Paragraph 85. "There is no Malcolm, you fool," Kedro says impatiently. "He's just a bogey we made up to placate the Kishan until the time was right to conquer their planet. Those creatures believe in magic and sorcery, so we created a magician to keep them from trying to investigate the Kaldor system too closely. It worked pretty well until your marines came along and botched it up." Kedro reaches over to the glowing terminal on his right and punches in a code. Now we have to launch an all-out attack on their planet and wipe out half their population. It's a shame, for they made wonderful servants. There, it's done. Within hours, there will not be much of the Kishan home world left for the survivors. Now, we must attend to you, my meddling marine friends. Kedro beckons to the other Blue Road Sentinels, who wheel over a large tubular apparatus. Kedro fiddles with the device for a moment, then points it at you.
Goodbye,
he whispers. With a loud pop, the device bathes you in an eerie red light. Fade to black. Paragraph 86. The scene that greets you as you enter the small cavern is not for the weak of heart. The ranchers have lined the cavern walls with grisly trophies of their war with the farmers. Two of your crew make mewling noises and proceed to lose their lunches when they see the heads mounted on the walls. Now you understand the reports of missing children. On the table in the center of the room is a Federation chart of Sejavik. Just to the north of the bio-research village is a small red dot labeled HQ. Below it, written in a neat, cramped hand, are the words, "The next 86 is 19. And last paragraph. Paragraph 88. The dying raider looks at you and whispers, "Find Malcolm. He dwells beyond the gates of truth. Tell him the Sentinels have returned. He'll know what to do." Well, if you listen to all this, kudos to you. It was a fun game. A little anticlimactic ending. Could have been done a little better. Could have been more different types of enemies, and maybe not so monotonous in some parts. But what do you want for 88? Some of these paragraphs I might be real. I might have not spoken to the correct person just because they're ridiculous, with the Sentinels saying the Sentinels are eat people and all that. And then there's the little romance between the farmer and the rancher. And unrequited or starstruck love. I don't know what you call that. Is it starstruck? I don't know. Well, yeah, some of that stuff might be true. And some might just, you know, be made up to intentionally misdirect you. Reading the fictional passages. There's a lot more passages that I haven't read than I did read. I mean, I've got maybe 15 that I've read out of 88. So, anyway. I'll put links in the description, well, notes in the description. The music you hear in the background is all by Skaven. This one is Past the Chase. The one on the last video, is called Network, and the one in the first, I believe I played it in 50 and 51, is Unreal 2. Anyway, all by Skaven at different periods in time, from the 90s, and this one I believe is 2004 or so. Yeah, he's a great artist, and I could leave a link to him also. But yeah, thanks for watching, thanks for listening, and I'm done with Sentinel Worlds. Thank God. Anyway, glad to be moving on. Take care.